Allora, il tuo talk adesso dovrebbe essere
l'introduzione.
If you feel, first of all, if you feel warm, I was outside of the camera. Yes, we are also streaming, so just for right. So I'm Enrico Bini. Thanks for coming. And right, I mean, without not spending too much words, I will just say. I can say the menu of the dinner, maybe it's not important. Well, welcome here in Pisa. If you feel warm, just open the window. And, well, thank you. And Luca, if you want to come to give a talk.
Okay.
First speaker is Luca Beni, who will give an overview about real-time systems. And it's more like theoretical oriented. Then we're going to have Yuri, who is entering into a bit of greater detail of scan data. Basically, the idea of the workshop is that today we try to go to the point of how to use scan data. So we need some theory of real time, which is going to be given by Luca. And then Yuri will explain us how to attach to threads, to set the parameters of threads. The bandwidth parameters. Then tomorrow is a bit more into detail. So we're going to have a talk by Marco Cesati first. Then I go on memory. I think it's Peter. And then we conclude the morning with Yuri entering into the details. Then I think we're going to have Michael explain us how to debug. And well, I will tell you tomorrow. Okay. Now yes, I just leave the ground to. Luca Beni from Trench. Giving the
thank you very much.
Overview
from just a minute to set up the computer and we're ready.
Okay. Ah yes. Who has the network? A network. Yes, right. It's very important. Also for our people watching us on streaming, the Wi-Fi. The Wi-Fi network is master, okay? And the password is master lowercase. That way, it's supposed to be written here. I will pass this around. Master lowercase, then percent 2566A lowercase. I will pass it around. Okay? Is it okay? Okay. The remote people said it's okay. So, who needs this? Who is the info? Okay, I'll pass it around, okay? Here from in the front, everybody has it. Okay, pass it around, big nose and pass it around.
Okay, so here we go. Sorry for the delay. So hello everyone. I am Luca Beni from University of Trento. I'm going to give you a short introduction about real-time scheduling, something about real-time scheduling algorithms, and a little bit of the theory which is behind sched deadline. Of course, I'm skipping a lot of things because we don't have much time. So if there is something which you think is interesting for you, of course you can ask, or here you can see my email address, so you can also contact me via email if you want additional references or material or whatever. So I'll try to make it not too boring and not too long. Let's see if it works. So first of all, some short introductions. Of course, I think you all already know what is a real-time application. A real-time application is an application for which it's not only important to generate correct results, but it's important to generate results at the correct time. So a correct result which is generated too late is more or less useless. And so we introduce this concept of temporal constraints or deadlines in order to model, in order to explain what is too late. So in a real-time application, we can say that some activity has to terminate before a specified time, which is a deadline, or some data has to be generated or has to be processed before a specified deadline, or some process or thread has to terminate before a deadline, and so on. So some other quick definitions, just to introduce some namings. During the talk, I'm not going to talk about processes or threads, because for at least from this simple scheduling point of view, it's not important for the scheduler to know if some activity is a process or if it's a thread. We just talk about schedulable entities. It's not important if they have private resources or not. So I'll talk about tasks. A task can be a process or a thread. In this context, it's not important. Of course, it is important in other contexts, but here we are just talking about the basics, and we just care about schedulable entities. And a real-time task can be modeled as a sequence of activities, and we need to associate a temporal constraint, a deadline, to each one of these activities. So we need some kind of formal mathematical model for a real-time task. And the model I'm going to use in this talk is this one. A task is a real-time task. We generally indicate it with the Greek letter tau. So the I real-time task is tau I, and is modeled as a stream, as a sequence of jobs, which are sometimes called task instances. So job J-I-K is the kth job of task tau I. Each job is characterized by some parameters. For example, job J-I-K is characterized by its arrival time, R-I-K, which is the time after which the job can be executed. So the time when a job becomes eligible for execution, for being scheduled. The job will have an execution time, the computational time, CIK, which is the amount of CPU time needed by the job to finish its work. And then, of course, the job is characterized by an absolute deadline, DIK, which is a time instant, and the job has to finish before this deadline. So here we can see a graphical representation of a job, which is just one activity, one of the activities which compose the task. This job arrives at this time. After this time, the scheduler is free to schedule the job for execution. The job will execute for an amount of time, CIK, which is its execution time. And after that, the job will finish at time FIK. And the deadline, the absolute deadline, the IK of the job, is respected if the finishing time is smaller or equal than the absolute deadline. So summing up, this job is just an abstraction that we use to associate temporal constraints, to associate deadlines to activities. Okay, as I said, a job respects its deadline if its finishing time is smaller or equal than the absolute deadline of the job. And we can also define a response time of the job, which is defined as rho ik, and is the difference between the finishing time and the arrival time of the job. So a real-time task, as I told you, is a sequence of jobs. This is a sequence of jobs often has some kind of structure, some cyclical structure. So we can have periodic tasks, or we can also have sporadic tasks. A periodic task is one is a task in which the arrival time of job of the k plus one job, so ri k plus one, is equal to the arrival time of the previous job plus a period. Generally, the absolute deadline of the job is equal to its arrival time plus a constant, which is a constant for the task, and is called relative deadline for task I. And then we can also talk about the worst case execution time, CI, for a task, which is basically the maximum between the execution times of the jobs composing the task. This was a periodic task. A sporadic task is something similar, but the arrival times are not regular. So in a sporadic task, the arrival time of job k plus 1 is not equal to the arrival time of job k plus the period, but is larger or equal, greater or equal than
the arrival time of the previous job plus a constant, which in this case for sporadic tasks is called minimum inter-arrival time. So for periodic tasks, arrivals are periodic with a specified period. For sporadic tasks, arrivals have a minimum distance, which is called minimum inter-arrival time. Okay, so here is an example of what a periodic task can look like in practice. If we implement it by using a thread, we will have this kind of thread body in which we have an initialization phase. Then we can start some kind of periodic timer if the task has to be periodic. And then we enter a loop. And the body of this loop will be the body of a job. So inside the loop, we do something, which is the job body. So we execute a job. And then we block the task waiting for the next activation, waiting for the arrival of the next job. If the task is periodic, we can use some kind of periodic timer mechanism, and we wait for the next periodic activation. Actually, a periodic task can be implemented by using clock nanosleep and sleeping for an absolute time, which is better than activating a timer. So from the graphical point of view, I generally represent tasks, real-time tasks in this way. I use up arrows to indicate job arrivals, which are basically wake-ups for the task. I use a down arrow to indicate absolute deadlines, and then these gray boxes indicate the time instance in which the task is scheduled. So for example, here we have a periodic task with period 8, so the first job arrives at time 0, the second at time 8, the third at time 16, and so on. And the relative deadline for this task is 6. So the deadline of the absolute deadline of the first job is 6. The absolute deadline of the second job is 8 plus 6, which is 14. The absolute deadline for the third job is 16 plus 6, 22, and so on. You can see that after the job arrival, the scheduler is free to schedule the job, the task, as it prefers. Here you see the task is immediately scheduled, then it's preempted, then it's scheduled again, and here the first job finishes. In the second job, you see a different schedule, and you can also see that the execution time of the second job is smaller than the execution time of the first job. So the worst case execution time of this task seems to be 3, which is the maximum between the execution times of all of the jobs. So after this quick introduction, let's go and talk about real-time scheduling. So we have this set of real-time tasks, set of tasks tau i, which are characterized by their worst-case execution times, relative deadlines, periods or minimum inter-arrival times. Sometimes we have a relative deadline which is equal to the period or not. The problem is how should the operating system kernel, how should Linux schedule these tasks so that all the jobs deadlines are respected? Of course, the scheduling algorithm is important. So the scheduler must have some way to know the temporal constraints, to know the deadlines of the various tasks and the various jobs. Otherwise, it will not be able to respect all of these deadlines. So the first question which we could ask is, which kind of scheduling algorithm can we use in this situation? Is it possible to have a scheduling algorithm which is able to respect all of the deadlines? Is it possible to know in advance if some deadline will be missed or not? And most of all, does the Linux kernel provide some kind of scheduling algorithm which is suitable for scheduling these real-time tasks? First, a stupid example. The first come, first served scheduling algorithm is not good for real-time tasks. Consider two simple real-time tasks, two periodic tasks. The first one has period 3, second one has period 8. First one has execution time equal to 1, second one has execution time equal to 4. So we have the arrival of the first jobs for the two tasks at time zero. Let's assume that task one is scheduled first. It executes for one time unit. Then the system can schedule the second task. Notice that a first come, first serve scheduler will schedule this job without any kind of preemption. So even if we have an arrival for the second job of task one at time three, this task will not be scheduled here because this job arrived first. So the second job of task one is scheduled at time five. Then at time six, we have the arrival for the third job of task one, which is immediately executed. At time seven, the CPU becomes idle. At time eight, we have a new arrival for the second job of task two, which is scheduled. At time nine, we have an arrival for the fourth job of task one, which is not scheduled because the first come, first serve scheduler schedules the job who arrived first, which is the second job of task two, which executes for four time units. So it finishes at time 12. And so you can see that the fourth job of task one cannot be properly scheduled. If you try to repeat this schedule by using fixed priorities and you give a higher priority to top one respect to top two, this is the resulting schedule. And as you can see, all of the jobs are able to respect their deadlines. So it seems that fixed priorities can be good for real-time scheduling. So good question is, are fixed priorities enough when we have real-time applications? So is this fact that real-time priorities are OK, is this a general result, or is it just specific to the example I presented? And moreover, how to assign the fixed priorities? If fixed priority scheduling can be used for real-time tasks, How can we assign fixed priorities to the tasks? And how can we know in advance if the deadlines will be respected or not using this priority assignment? If fixed priorities are enough, then the Linux kernel provided the support for real-time tasks since years, because you can use schedFIFO or schedRoundRobin. You have fixed priorities and everything is fine. So the problem, how to assign priorities, there are two very well-known priority assignments, which are called rate monotonic and deadline monotonic. Rate monotonic is used when the relative deadline of the task is equal to the task period or to the minimum inter-arrival time, and says give a higher priority to tasks with a shorter period. So if we return to the previous example, this priority assignment follows the rate monotonic rule. Task one has a shorter period, and so it has a higher priority. Deadline monotonic is similar. You use it when the relative deadline of the task is different from the period, and says give a higher priority to tasks with a smaller relative deadline. So the problem is, using rate monotonic or deadline monotonic, can we know in advance if some deadline will be missed or not? If we reduce ourselves to think about uniprocessor systems, so let's think for a moment about single processors. If we think about single processors, we have, using rate monotonic or deadline monotonic, we have a simple kind of schedulability analysis, which is the utilization-based analysis, which allows us to say in advance if a task set will respect all of the deadlines or not. Basically, given a scheduling algorithm, there is a constant called least upper bound for the utilization, U-loop. If the utilization of the task set, which I'm going to introduce in the next slide, sorry, I'm going backward. Anyway, if the utilization of the task set is smaller than this constant, then the task set is schedulable and all of the deadlines will be respected. Otherwise, we cannot say anything about the schedule. So how can we compute the utilization of a task set? If the relative deadline of a task is equal to the period of the task, we can compute the utilization of a task, UI, utilization of task UI, as the ratio between worst case execution time and task period. So the total system utilization is the sum of all the utilizations of the real-time tasks. This basically measures the processor load. So the utilization-based analysis says that if the total utilization, if the sum of all of the worst case execution time divided by the period for all of the tasks is larger than one, then the task set is not schedulable. There is no way that any scheduling algorithm can respect all of the deadlines just because the system is overloaded. So there is no hope. If U is larger than one, there is no hope. If U is smaller than one, then the task set can be schedulable or not. This depends on the scheduling algorithm. If we use fixed priorities and we use the rate monotonic priority assignment, then the least upper bound for the utilization depends on the number of tasks, and is the number of tasks, and is given by this equation. So if we have two tasks in the system, the least upper bound is 0.828. So if the total utilization is smaller or equal than 0.828, then all of the deadlines of all of the tasks will be respected. Otherwise, if the utilization is between this number and one, we do not know. If the utilization is larger than one, there is no hope to respect all of the deadlines. You can see for three tasks, the least upper bound for rate monotonic is a little bit smaller, and it's always decreasing. For very large number of tasks, the least upper bound of the utilization tends to 0.69. So if you do not remember this equation, you can just compute the total utilization, compare it with 0.69, and this can give a first idea about the fact that the system is able, rate monotonic is able to schedule, probably schedule the tasks or not. So what can we do in case of tasks with relative deadlines smaller than period? We can just compute a different kind of utilization, dividing the worst case execution time by the relative deadline of the task. This is more pessimistic, but it can be give a sufficient condition for schedulability. And here is an example of a task set which has utilization equal to 1. So it's larger than the utilization least upper bound, but it's still schedulable by fixed priorities using rate monotonic. This is just to show you that the utilization-based analysis is pessimistic. Okay. So this was about fixed priority scheduling. So you see, if the system utilization is not too high and we limit ourselves to single processor systems, we can use fixed priorities. In fact, there are a lot of real-time systems around, the real-time operating systems around, which just work fine with fixed priority. Problem is, can we do something better than fixed priority scheduling? We can try to use dynamic priorities. So to dynamically change the priority.
Yes. So the big problem I have with rate monotonic and data monotonic from an operating system point of view is that they always require middleware. Something that the application does its actual deadlines to compute the fixed priorities, which are then given to the actual operating system kernel. So it's basically implementing something simple in the kernel and then pushing some of the...
Yeah, it moves a lot of effort in the design phase. Yes.
Into the user space, and then if you have multiple sets of applications written against different middleware, the combinations of these applications can never run on a single system because the middleware does not talk to each other, and your entire scalability analysis comes out the window. But,
Thank you for the clarification. Yes. fixed priorities and rate monotonic can be okay for embedded systems when the designer at design time has already an idea of all of the real-time tasks that will run on the system. In this case, during the system design phase, you can assign priorities in an optimal way, and you can have a system which works. Of course, in a dynamic system, in a desktop operating system where applications are dynamically created or destroyed or can be independent one from the other, it's much more difficult to assign priorities. Right. So the idea is, can we do something better to solve, to address some of the problems with that we have with fixed priorities? The idea could be to use dynamic priorities, so to dynamically change the priority of the task. To simplify things a little bit, let's keep the priority of a job fixed. So a task can change its priority during execution, but we do not change, for the moment, the priority of a job. So we can assign to each job, to each task, a priority which is based on the absolute deadline of the current job. So we look at the absolute deadline of the job which is currently executing, and tasks with the earliest absolute deadline execute first. So this is the earliest deadline first scheduling algorithm, which is based on dynamic priorities. Every time a new job arrives, the priority of a task changes because the priority depends on the deadline of this job. And one important thing is not to confuse earliest deadline first, EDF, with DM, deadline monotonic. Earliest deadline first assigned priorities based on absolute deadlines. And the absolute deadline of a task changes every time a new job is released. Deadline monotonic assigns priorities based on relative deadlines, which are constant. Okay, so deadline monotonic is a fixed priority scheduling algorithm. Earliest deadline first is a dynamic priority algorithm. So which are the advantages of EDF? The first advantage is that if we consider only tasks with relative deadlines equal to periods, and again, we restrict ourselves to uniprocessor systems for a moment, then EDF is an optimal scheduling algorithm. What does it mean? It means that the least upper bound for the utilization is 1. This means that if the total utilization is smaller or equal than 1, then the task set is schedulable, and we have the mathematical guarantee that every job of every task will respect its deadline. Otherwise, if the utilization is larger than 1, we know that no scheduling algorithm will be able to respect all of the deadlines. So, in other words, we cannot do better than EDF. What happens if we have relative deadlines different from period? We can use utilization-based analysis using the relative deadline here instead of the period, but this is not, this analysis can become pessimistic. There are other kind of analyses which are not pessimistic, which are exact, but for EDF they are very complex, and I'm not going to talk about these here.
One note.
Yes.
The least upper bound of 1 is only true under the assumption of no overhead.
So yes, yes. I'm still talking about the mathematical model of the tasks. We are going to operating system later. Yes. Yeah. Of course, when everything runs on a real operating system, there is overhead. There are latencies coming from the kernel. I'll try to say something about that later. But yes, of course. Here we are still in an ideal world where everything reflects the mathematical model. So here I put a very simple and stupid example just to show the advantages of EDF.
Can I add just a comment?
The
ideal world is not that distant to the reality if we just inflate the computation time by some amount of overhead.
Yes, right? The problem is how much is this amount.
Okay.
And then we have to consider also blocking times, which here you cannot see, but
yes.
Yeah, due to no.
I mean, the problem is not in the model, right? It's in the interpretation that you can
Yeah, there are two different problems. One is in the interpretation of this CI, and the other one is really in the model, because this thing is not modeling the operating system.
Okay.
Resource contention and loading change and all that is just not in the model.
Sorry? Resource contention and... Ah, yes, this model still doesn't consider that. Yeah. I'm going to that later. Yeah, that, of course, here we are considering non-interactive tasks. We are still considering independent tasks. I'll arrive to interactive tasks later if there is time. So here, a very simple and stupid example. Two tasks with a relative deadline equal to the period. First task is has execution time equal to 3, period equal to relative deadline equal to 8. Second task has execution time equal to 6, period equal to relative deadline equal to 11. If you compute the utilization, you see it's 0.92. So EDF is able to schedule this task set. Let's see what happens with rate monotonic. At time 0, we have the arrival for the first two jobs. Of course, rate monotonic assigns higher priority to task one, so task one is scheduled. Then at time 3, when the first job of task one finishes, the task two can be scheduled. The execution time is 6, but we can execute only for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 time units. And then we have an arrival for the second job of task one, which is going to preempt the first job of task two. This second job of task one executes for 3 time units, and then it finishes. And here we are too late to finish this job in time. So task one is immediately missing a deadline. Okay. What happens with EDF? Again, we have a simultaneous arrival of two jobs at time 0. This job has a shorter deadline, so the first job of task 1 is scheduled first, then it finishes at time 3. Here we can schedule task 2, which is scheduled up to time 8. Then the second job of task 1 arrives. It has deadline 16, so the shortest deadline task is still tau 2, which can continue to execute. And then the second job of task 1 can be executed. Then we have the second job of task tau 2, and so on. And you can go on and you will see that no deadline is missed. So this simple and stupid example should already provide some evidence that EDF has advantages with respect to rate monotonic. So now let's go on. Let's consider real-world systems. Today, only the number of systems with only one CPU or only one core is very limited. Today, most of the systems have multiple CPUs or CPUs with multiple cores. So which kind of algorithm can we use in this case? Basically, we have two possibilities, mainly two possibilities. There are others, but we will focus on these two, which are partition scheduling or global scheduling. The goal is still to have a scheduling algorithm which is able to schedule the tasks respecting all of the deadlines of all of the jobs. We would like to have an optimal scheduling algorithm. We know that on uniprocessor systems, EDF is optimal. The question is, can we find some kind of optimal scheduling algorithm for multiprocessor systems? So an optimal scheduling algorithm on multiprocessor systems would be a scheduling algorithm which is able to respect all of the deadlines of all of the tasks when the total utilization is smaller or equal than M, where M is the number of CPUs or the number of the CPU cores. The first idea is the simplest one, maybe, is partition scheduling. So let's statically partition tasks between CPUs. We statically assign each task to a specific CPU. So every CPU will have its own ready task queue. Tasks cannot migrate from one CPU to the other. In this way, we reduce the problem of scheduling on M CPUs to M instances of the problem of scheduling on one CPU. So we can reuse algorithms that we know are working well on single CPUs. So we can reuse rate monotonic, we can reuse EDF, whatever. If we use EDF with partitioned scheduling, we have to use some kind of bin packing algorithm so that we assign tasks to the CPUs so that every CPU has a load smaller or equal than one. The problem is this possible? There are situations in which tasks cannot be easily partitioned between CPUs. For example, think about a dual processor system with these three real-time tasks. Execution time equal to 6 and period equal to relative deadline equal to 10. It's not possible to distribute these tasks between the two CPUs having a utilization smaller or equal than 1 on every CPU. So this kind of task set cannot be scheduled correctly using partition scheduling. So partition scheduling is simple, allows us to reuse many of the results we have from a uniprocessor scheduling, but unfortunately, it cannot be used when the task set is not partitioned. So the other possible approach is global scheduling. From the conceptual point of view, from the ideal point of view, we only have one single task queue. We select the first M tasks from this task queue, and we distribute them on the various CPUs. This is the ideal model of global scheduling. Of course, this can be implemented by having different ready queues for every CPU and then migrating tasks from one run queue to the other in order to have this global ordering. Anyway, the idea is to have conceptually, one ready task queue, which is ordered according to fixed priorities or according to EDF or to some other scheduling algorithm, and to select the first M tasks to schedule them. The problem with this approach is that the least upper bound for this global scheduling approach is surprisingly low. For example, it can be shown that a global EDF, so a global scheduler like this, which uses EDF for ordering this task queue, global EDF has a least upper bound equal to 1. So there are situations in which the total system utilization is near to 1, but global EDF is not able to respect all of the deadlines. So there is no improvement respect to uniprocessor systems in this sense. Because for EDF on a uniprocessor, the least upper bound was 1. On multiprocessors, regardless of the number of CPUs, the least upper bound is still 1. So it seems that there is no improvement. In reality, there is an improvement using multiple CPUs with global EDF. Maybe global EDF is not able to respect all of the deadlines, but it can provide an upper bound for the so-called tardiness. What is the tardiness? The tardiness is the difference between the finishing time of a task and the absolute deadline of the task. So the tardiness tells us how much late is the task. Okay, and so global EDF cannot be used in case of hard real-time scheduling. If we want to strictly respect all of the deadlines, global EDF is not a good choice. But if we are okay with soft real-time, if we allow tasks to miss their deadlines, and we care about having an upper bound about how much time the task is late, then global EDF is a good choice. Problem with global scheduling can also be that tasks tend to migrate from one CPU to another. And so migrations are overhead because of they need inter-processor interrupts, because of cache problems, and so on. So this can create some overhead. And this overhead and these migrations are not accounted for in the admission tests. So this was just a short, very short overview about some possible scheduling algorithms we can use for real-time tasks. Now let's see how to use this stuff in Linux. If we want to use fixed priorities, we can use SCED5 or SCED round robin, the SCED5 or SCED round robin scheduling policies. We can do that since many years ago, so it's nothing new. As Peter mentioned before, this can be a good idea if the system, our system is an embedded system. If we know in advance all of the tasks that will run in the system, then we can know how to assign priorities in advance. If we have real-time tasks which can be created dynamically, maybe we would have to rearrange priorities dynamically every time the a task is created, so we could have problems. Of course, Linux provides system calls for setting the scheduling policy for a task, for setting the scheduling priority, for knowing the minimum and the maximum priority we can use for a task, and so on. So let's see another problem with when using real-time priorities in Linux. Let's assume our application contains a bad task or simply contains a bug, and we have a high-priority real-time task which enters an endless loop more or less like this. If the task has a high real-time priority, this task can consume all of the CPU time on a CPU core. If we have enough tasks like these, or if we have only one core, then the system can become basically unusable because our real-time tasks are consuming all of the CPU time. There is no way for preventing this. So for this reason, real-time priorities can be used only by the system administrator or by someone which has appropriate capabilities. Linux addresses this problem by introducing the real-time throttling mechanism, which just measures how much time a real-time task is executing and basically blocks a real-time task when it's trying to execute it for too much time. So this mechanism, this real-time throttling mechanism can prevent this kind of starvation problem. But the problem is, how does real-time throttling interact with the schedulability analysis I showed you before about rate monotonic? How does it interact with the theoretical model of rate monotonic scheduling? So real-time throttling is a very useful mechanism. It's important if we want to have real-time applications in a desktop system, but we need something which has some theoretical foundation, let's say, which allows to perform schedulability analysis even when some kind of throttling mechanism is used. Let's see how we can use EDF on Linux. In order to use EDF, of course, the kernel should know the absolute deadlines of tasks. Unfortunately, until some months ago, the Linux kernel was not aware of these task deadlines, so it could not use EDF. Today, the Linux kernel has a mechanism which allows it to know about the task deadlines, and so EDF can be used. I'm going to talk about that a little bit later. Anyway, some kind of more advanced API respect to the standard SCED-SET scheduler mechanism is needed. SCED-SET scheduler only allowed to specify a priority for the task. If we want to use EDF, we need to at least specify a relative deadline, and we will see that it's better to specify also a runtime and a period. I'm going to talk about that later. So the idea is that the kernel somehow should be able to compute the absolute deadline of a task by summing a relative deadline, which is passed through this advanced API. Yuri will tell you about it. So this relative deadline is summed to the arrival time of a job. So the new problem is, how can the kernel know when a new job is arriving. So the scheduler is not aware about jobs. It only knows about tasks, about processes or threads. It doesn't know when a job starts, when a job finishes. So it cannot use this kind of equation in order to compute the absolute deadline for a task. So there are two possibilities. The first one, if we want to go with a pure EDF scheduler, there are two possibilities. The first one is to modify every application which wants to use EDF and modify the application adding some kind of system calls to indicate when a job is starting or when a job is finishing. In this way, the kernel becomes aware of the jobs and can compute this kind the absolute deadline of each task. The other possibility is for the kernel to assume that every time a task goes to sleep and if every time a task blocks, a job is finished, and every time a task wakes up, a new job arrives. So if we consider the original task model I showed you at the beginning, this kind of assumption could be consistent. A task blocks only when a job finishes. Unfortunately, in reality, there are a lot of applications which we may want to schedule with EDF and which are blocking for a lot of reasons for while reading data from the file system or from the network or whatever, even in the middle of a job. So this assumption can be very, very dangerous. An alternative approach could be this one. The kernel has some kind of algorithm to assign scheduling deadlines to tasks. So the kernel cannot know the absolute deadline of every job of the task because the kernel doesn't know when a job starts and when a job finishes. But the kernel computes in some way some scheduling deadlines, associate them to the tasks, and then every task can be scheduled by using EDF based on this scheduling deadline, which is assigned by the kernel by using an algorithm, which I'm going to show in the next slides. Now, if this scheduling deadline matches the absolute deadline of a job, then EDF allows to respect the job deadlines. So the idea is having an algorithm to generate scheduling deadlines, associate them to the tasks, then use EDF on these scheduling deadlines. And then if our algorithm is smart enough, and if we can ensure that the scheduling deadlines and the job deadlines are coincident, then the task will be scheduled correctly, and the job absolute deadlines will be respected. So the algorithm used to assign scheduling deadlines to the tasks is the constant bandwidth server, CBS, which is a resource reservation algorithm. The idea of a reservation algorithm is to ensure that the task is allowed to execute for a maximum runtime QI every reservation period PI. So the task is guaranteed to have this amount of execution time every period, and the task is not allowed to execute for more than this time every period. If the task tries to execute for more than this, the kernel scheduler will block it or will decrease its priority or will do something so that it will not use too much execution time. On the other hand, the scheduler guarantees that this amount of time will be available every period for the task. This allows to implement a property called temporal isolation. The temporal isolation ensures that the worst case finishing time of a task does not depend on the other tasks running on the system, depends only on the task itself. So, because it depends on these QI and PI, and so it's possible to guarantee the respect of the deadlines of a task independently from the other tasks running in the system. If I introduce in the system a bad task and which is trying to consume too much execution time, and this task is scheduled by the by using the CBS, this task will not be able to affect the schedulability of the other tasks running in the system.
Okay.
So, let's see some more details about the constant bandwidth server. The idea is that we'll serve an amount of time QI every period PI to the task. If a task tries to execute too much, the algorithm can make it unschedulable, for example. In this way, the task will never consume more time than a periodic task with the worst case execution time equal to QI and the period equal to PI. So we can reuse the EDF schedulability analysis using these two CBS parameters instead of the task parameters. So if we use EDF on the scheduling deadlines assigned by the constant bandwidth server, then on uniprocessor systems, we can guarantee that each task will be guaranteed to receive QI every PI if this admission test is expected. And this is the admission test we have seen for EDF before. On multiprocessor systems, we can change this one with the number of processors. And then we can guarantee that the task will receive its amount of time QI every period PI with the maximum delay. Because if we use a global EDF, we can have an upper bound on the tardiness of the task, as I told you before. So summing up, the constant bandwidth server uses EDF. It assigns scheduling deadlines. EDF is used on the scheduling deadlines. So we have a good CPU utilization. We know that for a uniprocessor systems, EDF is optimal. The constant bandwidth server also allows to serve non-periodic tasks because it's designed to assign scheduling deadlines even if job arrivals are not periodic. Some reservation-based scheduling algorithms have problems with non-periodic arrivals. The constant bandwidth server can tolerate non-periodic arrivals. And also, using the constant bandwidth server to assign scheduling deadlines, we don't have problem with the so-called self-suspending tasks, with tasks which block in the middle of a job. So the constant, if we use the constant bandwidth server to assign scheduling deadlines, we do not have to make assumptions like when a task blocks, the job is finished, or when a task wakes up, a new job arrives. Okay.
Small question.
Yes.
Should a real-time task ever work? Isn't that just wrong?
Sorry?
Should a real-time task ever work? Isn't that just wrong by design?
Please repeat the question, Luca. Can you please repeat the question?
If you ask if a real-time task should ever block, right?
Shouldn't be written that it never blocks?
Yeah, of course. If you are designing a real-time application from scratch, you can design it so that the real-time task never blocks in the middle of the job, so that you respect the so-called Liu and Leyland task model, and everything is fine. But the goal when designing deadline was to allow to schedule even, let's say, legacy applications which are developed not thinking about the real-time task model, and these applications block a lot of times.
If they block, what kind of guarantee can you have?
With the constant bandwidth server, you can still have some kind of guarantees. Because the constant bandwidth server allows to assign scheduling deadlines without making assumptions about these. With EDF, without any kind of algorithm for assigning scheduling deadlines, you would assign a new deadline every time the task wakes up. Just an example, with the sched deadline, you can get, let's say, M player and schedule it with the sched deadline. And there are experiments showing that you can control, for example, the jitter in the interframe time, or you can control the audio-video desynchronization by just playing with the sket deadline parameters and player blocks a lot of times during a job just because it reads videos from the disk or whatever. So yeah, I agree with you that if you design an application from scratch, you can design it not to block. Yes.
Yes, if blocks, yes, no guarantee. At least from disk, it will take any time.
You can, no have, you can have no guarantee for this application. The problem is if you use EDF without any kind of algorithm to assign scheduling deadlines, an application which blocks in the middle of a job can compromise the schedulability even of other applications which are good. With this rule for assigning scheduling deadlines, if an application does something stupid, the application itself can suffer, but the other applications which are well behaved will not suffer. And then there are experiments showing that even with not well behaving applications, you can manage to have a controllable quality of service using this kind of algorithm.
Okay.
Okay, so this is the constant bandwidth server algorithm in details. So the algorithm uses a quantity which is the scheduling deadline to assign dynamic priorities to the tasks. And it uses a runtime to account, a current runtime to account for the amount of time executed by a task. Basically, both of these quantities are initialized to zero when the task is created, and when a job arrives, the algorithm checks if the current deadline and the current runtime can be used without compromising the schedulability of the other tasks. And here there is a funny mathematical equation which can be used for checking this. If this deadline and runtime can be used, then the deadline and runtime are left unchanged and the task is scheduled according to the current scheduling deadline. Otherwise, a new scheduling deadline is generated in this way and the runtime is recharged to the maximum value. This equation is interesting because I think tomorrow you will see it in the Linux kernel, if I remember well. Okay, then when a task executes, the runtime is, of course, decreased, nothing strange here. And when the runtime arrives to zero, the task is throttled, so it cannot be scheduled until its scheduling deadline is reached. When the scheduling deadline is reached, the scheduling deadline is postponed, and the current runtime is recharged using the maximum value. So sket deadline is just implementing this algorithm, the constant bandwidth server algorithm to associate scheduling deadlines and the EDF algorithm to schedule tasks inside the Linux kernel. All sket deadline tasks are scheduled in foreground respect to all the other scheduling policies. So there is an admission control which allows to check if the total utilization is smaller than the number of current CPUs, just not to starve the other tasks. Each task can be assigned a runtime and a period, which are the parameters I showed you talking about the CDS. Sket deadline also allows to specify an additional parameter, which is a relative deadline. And this check, which I showed here, is used, tomorrow you will see it inside the kernel, is used to check if the current scheduling deadline and the current budget can be used, and the current runtime can be used. EDF is used to schedule tasks, and sket deadline supports both global or partitioned schedulers. So if you do not configure anything particular, global scheduling is used, but you can use the CPU set mechanism in order to isolate some CPUs and to use partitioned scheduling if you want to respect hard deadlines. Okay, so this is the admission test I showed you before, and it's implemented inside the Linux kernel. Of course, since you have other non-scheduled deadline tasks executing in background, maybe it's better to use a number here which is a little bit smaller than M, so that you can leave some time for the background tasks, for the non-scheduled deadline tasks. Okay, Yuri will describe the API you can use in order to specify the maximum runtime, the period, and the relative deadline for each task. Now, the problem is, I told you that everything is fine if we can ensure that scheduling deadlines matches the task deadlines. Is it possible to ensure this? Yes, there are some. There is some theoretical analysis which has been performed on the constant bandwidth server algorithm, and there is a property of the algorithm which is called hard schedulability property. It says that if you assign a maximum runtime which is larger or equal than the task worst case execution time, and you assign a period which is smaller or equal than the task period or minimum interval time, then you can ensure that there will be a coincidence between the scheduling deadlines and the task deadlines. And so the kernel scheduler will allow to respect all of the scheduling, all of the deadlines of all of the jobs of the task. On uniprocessor systems, you are able to respect hard deadlines, so to respect all of the deadlines. If you use multiple processors and you use global scheduling, you can provide guarantees on the tardiness, on the worst case tardiness. Now, the other interesting problem is what happens if we do not exactly know the worst case execution time of a task, so we are not able to assign a maximum runtime larger than the worst case execution time. Of course, the ratio between runtime and reservation period should be larger or equal than the ratio between the average execution time and the average interarrival time. Otherwise, the scheduling deadlines will diverge and the task schedule will be uncontrollable. But if you assign maximum runtimes which are smaller than the worst case execution time, and you respect this condition, it's possible to perform some kind of a stochastic analysis so that without changing anything in the scheduling algorithm, you can somehow compute the probability to respect the deadline or something similar using Markov chains or using some kind of stochastic analysis. There is some literature about how to perform this computation, and there are also ways to do this kind of stochastic analysis online. Other interesting thing, what happens if the task parameters change at runtime? So execution times are not constant, interarrival time may be not constant. So can the scheduling algorithm cope with these variations? There are various ways to cope with variations. Basically, you can have short-term variations in the, for example, execution times. For example, if a job consumes less than the maximum runtime, maybe you can donate these the remaining runtime to some other tasks. This is called CPU reclaiming, and there are some scheduling algorithms which improve EDF and the constant bandwidth server in order to perform CPU reclaiming. This could be implemented, has not been done, but could be implemented as a modification to the current scheduler. But the tasks can also have longer term variations in their execution times. So for example, if there is a mode change in the application or something similar, in this case, it could be interesting to adapt the scheduling parameters, the maximum runtime or the period of the task to cope with these longer term variations. This could be done by using a mechanism which is called adaptive reservations. Basically, you can monitor the current scheduling deadline of the task. You compare it with the current absolute deadline of the currently executing job of the task. If this difference increases too much, it means that the task has not been assigned enough runtime, so you should somehow increase this maximum runtime. If this difference becomes smaller or equal than zero, then you can decrease this maximum runtime. Since these are longer term variations, you can react more slowly to them. And so all these mechanisms, adaptive mechanisms, can be implemented in user space. Everything which is needed is the possibility to read, to know the current scheduling deadline of a task. So you can implement a daemon, which in user space reads the current scheduling deadline of the task, knows the current absolute deadline of the current job of the task, and so can compute this difference and maybe use control theory or whatever in order to adapt this maximum runtime. For both CPU reclaiming and adaptive reservations, there is a huge literature. If you're interested, just write me an email and I reply with a lot of references and theoretical things. Finally, last slide, I promise, is about the things I did not say in this talk, because there was not enough time. So what, as Peter mentioned before, up to now I talked about independent tasks. So I did not talk about interaction between tasks. Of course, real tasks, real threads, real processes will interact, maybe through shared resources or maybe through inter-process communication. Of course, real-time theory can model this situation too. So there are some techniques which can be used in order to cope with interacting tasks. If you use fixed priorities, you can use priority inheritance, which is already implemented in the Linux kernel. If you use EDF, you can use dynamic priority inheritance, so let's say deadline inheritance. In case we have scheduling deadlines and budgets, we can use an inheritance mechanism which allows to inherit both the runtime and deadlines, and it's called bandwidth inheritance. And it's not implemented in SCED deadline yet, but people are already working on that. And Yuri will probably update you on this today or tomorrow. Other important thing, there is a huge difference between all the theoretical mathematical model in which tasks are ideal and which everything is fine, and what happens on a real machine where we have interrupts, where we have a kernel which is executing, which is maybe not too preemptable, and so on. So there can be a difference, and there actually is a difference between the theoretical schedule, which is dictated by the scheduling algorithm, and the actual schedule, which is implemented by the kernel. Even using a fixed priority scheduling, there are some situations in which a high priority task is ready for execution, but the scheduler is not the kernel is not scheduling it because it's doing something else, or it's in a non-preemptable section, or whatever. So all of these effects can be modeled as blocking times, and real-time theory provides some tools for coping with blocking times. Of course, these blocking times should not be too large, otherwise all the theoretical guarantees are compromised. And this is what the preemptive patch for Linux is for. Basically, PreemptRT is modifying the Linux kernel in order to provide a bounded kernel latency in order to have an actual schedule which matches the theoretical schedule as much as possible. Final other things I did not mention is about optimal scheduling algorithms for multiple processors. Global EDF is not optimal, but there are some other algorithms. Okay, that's all. I hope it was not too long or too boring.
Certainly, thank you, Professor.
Regarding the upper bound of the turbines, is there a known upper bound on the upper bound in terms of?
Yes, yes, yes. There are papers providing you equations for computing this upper bound when using global EDF. I can provide you with some references. I don't have them here, but I can search for them. If you look at the Jim Anderson published a lot of papers just on this upper bound for the tardiness on global EDF.
So it's a value which is still leaving the system usable. It's not
yes.
Bound which can.
No. It's an upper bound which should be quite useful.
Yeah, one question.
This
part of the constant server is Q. Two parameter and the other one were P.
Budget and the P.
Yes, and these are set when you create a task, or are they calculated in runtime or how?
The two parameters Q and P.
Yes.
Yeah. With you have a modified set scheduler call which allow you to.
His talk is exactly how to set those values.
Okay, anyway, there is a new system call which is implementing a new API for setting these two. Now, the problem is about how to dimension these parameters. There are various possibilities. During the design phase of your application, you know an estimate for the worst case execution timer for the period, you can use them for in order to use the hard schedulability property. Or if you know some kind of probability distribution for the execution times, you can use this probability distribution in order to compute Q and P so that you control the probability to respect the deadline. Or you can also have some kind of dynamic adaptation mechanism, which is dynamically adapting the maximum budget, the maximum runtime, sorry, so that some kind of temporal constraints are respected.
But these parameters C and D, they are not known. You cannot know them for any task. C and D parameters.
The C and D parameters. Okay, if they are not known, you can use a feedback mechanism when running the application. That's the adaptive reservation approach. You start with an estimation and then you use control theory or whatever in order to adapt them.
Do you know if anybody has created an implementation of the adaptive reservation system yet?
I had one, but it worked for an old version.
We also had one in the Actors project, which was the first versions of this patch. It was fancy this research, and there was an adaptive QoS mechanism in the Actors project.
Yeah, but there are many efforts.
The next thing is to implement it, but it's highly application dependent.
Anyway, this can be implemented without any change to the kernel schedule. The only change you need is to read this value, to let a user space task know this value. Then you can compute the feedback in user space and can use some system call to adapt the parameters without modifying the scheduler.
I think some people from Huawei were interested in the CPU reclaim stuff with the Chrome.
Yeah.
And I've been interested in the stochastic approach. All we need to do is make sure that the task is actually behaving according to the stochastic propagation behavior. So we need to have some internal validation of the stochastic propagation.
Yeah, something like a feedback at runtime, basically.
So we can have a short average window of the runtimes to validate that it is indeed averaging to the average you gave it and not abort of that. But we can talk about that.
Yeah.
But it would be nice to have firm support for that and allow
I may. I may be wrong, but I think the kernel, at least if debugging is enabled, the kernel already provided everything needed. At least I've seen one version of the patch in which I could read the debug FS or something, the execution time of the last job.
Yeah, it's not there anymore, but yeah, it was.
It was there. I've seen that once a time, and I had some programming user space using that.
We can do it.
Yeah. Okay. So it could be easy to.
We stripped out everything to get it to a minimal patch. And then build on that. And another thing that is really missing is sanity checking on the parameters, so we can allow privileged use of this policy. Because currently, if you set, for example, your period very low, you can deny all service.
Or even for very long periods, and large budgets.
So we need some windows on some of these parameters to allow increased use. That's also another thing that needs to be done. So currently, it's only with privilege that you can use this policy, but move that around to also in that.
I'm wondering whether we should we take a break or we vote. Who wants to take a break? Raise the hand. Want to continue?
Bye bye.
Take a break. Okay.